I invite you to take out your Bibles this morning as we turn to God's Word, and we're going to continue in our series of 1 Corinthians, and we're up to chapter 3. Chapter 3 of 1 Corinthians, and we're going to read the first 12 verses of 1 Corinthians 3, or the 23 verses of 1 Corinthians 3. And as we do so each week, if you are able, please stand as we stand before God and listen to Him speak to us through His Word. 1 Corinthians 3, beginning at verse 1, hear these words from the Lord. Brothers, I could not address you as spiritual, but only as worldly, mere infants in Christ. I gave you milk, not solid food, for you were not yet ready for it. Indeed, you are still not ready. You are still worldly. For since there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not worldly? Are you not acting like mere men? For when one says, I follow Paul, and another, I follow Apollos, are you not mere men? What, after all, is Apollos? And what is Paul? Only servants, through whom you come to believe as the Lord has assigned to each his task. I planted the seed, Apollos watered it, but God made it to grow. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who makes things grow. The man who plants and the man who waters have one purpose, and each will be rewarded according to his own labor. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, God's building. But by the grace God has given me, I laid a foundation as an expert builder, and someone else is building on it. But each one should be careful how he builds. For no one can lay any foundation other than the one already that has been laid, which is Jesus Christ. If any man builds on this foundation, using gold, silver, costly stones, wood, hay, or straw, his work will be shown for what it is, because the day will bring it to light. It will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each man's work. If what he has built survives, he will receive his reward. If it is burned up, he will suffer loss. He himself will be saved, but only as one who has escaped through the flames. Don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple, and that God's Spirit lives within you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him, for God's temple is sacred, and you are that temple. Do not deceive yourselves. If any one of you thinks he is wise by the standards of this age, he should become a fool so that he may become wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness in God's sight. As it is written, he catches the wise in their craftiness. And again, the Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, knows that the thoughts of the wise are futile. So then, no more boasting about men. All things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas, or the world, or life, or death, or the present, or the future, all are yours, and you are Christ, and Christ is of God. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. We've talked about, in this series of in Corinthians, about the fact that we are consecrated, that we are set apart for purposes. The first week we saw that we were set aside, set apart for loyalty, for unity amongst each other, unity. And the second week we saw that we were set apart for loyalty, loyalty to Christ. We have the mind of Christ. We have been enriched and richly blessed with all of God's blessings. Today, we're going to look at this text and see that we are set apart, we are consecrated for service, for service. Are any of you wealthy enough that you have servants in your house? I don't see anybody raising hands, and I don't think that you would if you did. No, none of us really have servants in our home, So when we talk about service, we have a different sort of cultural understanding of what service is. Service is what happens when we go to a restaurant and we get a waiter who messes up our order. That's bad service. Or when we go to a store and we we stand in line and we wait for someone to help us, and when they finally come, they are really of no help. That's poor service. And then we have times when we go to a restaurant and we order and the food comes quickly and it's excellent. That's good service. But notice how service revolves around us, how people are serving us. I was visiting the country of Africa, and we were staying at by missionaries' houses, and we were surprised that missionaries, because, you know, missionaries aren't wealthy, but these missionaries had servants in their house. They had a lady that did all the cooking, a lady that came in and did the laundry, a man who was out in the yard trimming the bushes and mowing the lawn and taking care of the house. They had three servants, three of them. And we asked, how does a missionary afford a servant? And they explained it like this. So these servants are in need of some income. They need a job. And so we have these jobs that they can do, and they come and do them, and we pay them, and it doesn't cost us that much, but it actually is a life gift for them, because it actually makes a huge difference in their life. And not only that, but they are like our family. We consider them family. They're part of our home. They aren't simply servants. They're part of our family. And so I want to think about us as being servants, living a life of service as family members. And the family that we are a part of is the family of God. Okay? So put yourselves in the family of God and ask yourselves, how can we serve? How can we be a servant? The first thing that Paul says is that leaders are servants. And Paul's words are kind of harsh when he begins his text. And we might think that Paul is kind of grumpy today. He's kind of rubbing the sandpaper on the church. He's kind of chafing on them. He says, I cannot address you as spiritual. Wait a minute, this is the church. Isn't the church about spiritual matters? He says, no, I cannot address you as spiritual. I must address you as worldly. I came and I gave you milk because you needed milk. We know all about that now with the formula shortage, right? Because little babies, up until they're a year old, they need milk or formula. They can't digest and have solid food. So when they're young, when they're first born, they need milk. So Christians, they need spiritual milk. But you would expect them to be able to eat meat as they grow and as they progress. But he says, I can't give you meat yet because you are still like children. You're acting like children. You're not spiritual people. You're not mature. But you are people of the flesh. You are still people of the world. Now, we may think this is harsh, but the language that Paul is using is the language of the culture. It's the kind of language you would have heard daily, on a daily basis, if you were in the city square. If you were engaging in conversations with people, philosophers and the people of education and people that come with all their ideas, this is common language. They would be saying things like this about others and each other. And so Paul is saying, you think you are very spiritual. You think that you are mature in your faith. But as long as there is quarreling among you, that is not true. He says, there is jealousy and quarreling among you. There is, and you are of the world. Are you not being worldly? There is zeal. You know, we think that zeal is a good thing. It's good to be zealous. It's good to really, you know, take hold of something and say, I'm going to do this well. And so they have taken hold of the things that Paul has taught them and Apollos has taught them, and they're doing them well. but in their attempt to do church well, in their attempt to be good spiritual Christians, they have failed in one aspect. They have taken their eyes off of Christ. They have taken on their own mind and their own heart, and they have focused on themselves, who they are, what they're doing. And they have taken their eyes off the Master, the one who asks them and calls them and equips them to do the things that he wants to do. Are you not acting like mere men? We live in an age of competition, right? So some of you are involved in dance competition. Some of you are involved in soccer competition. Some of you are involved in baseball competition, track and field competition. Sometimes there's even competition in school or competition in the business world. We're constantly comparing ourselves to other people. So how do I measure up to that person? And we do it in church as well. How do I measure up to so-and-so? And oftentimes, we find ourselves not measuring up, and so we say, I'm not going to try anymore. You know? I can't measure up to that person. I can't compete. And the harder I try, the worse it gets. And so I'm just going to give up. Paul is saying, you have raised up these people, Paul or Apollos or Cephas or Christ, and you're trying to decide who has got the best and the biggest and silo that they can be a part of. He says, your living is worldly. You are zealous. You are lusting, living in the flesh. You're living in man-made standards. And so some of them assumed that they were better than others. They lost sight of the fact that they were there to serve God and to serve each other. And so Paul says, you are immature. You are like infants who still need help. Now, how many of you would leave your infant child home alone for the day while you go to work? Alone, by themselves, because they can take care of themselves, right? None of us would. Babies need someone watching them, caring for them. In fact, when you put them to sleep, you put monitors on so you can hear. And now you can even watch them, right? Back in the day, we had to go check and peek through the door, make sure that the hinges didn't creak, because then that would wake the baby up. Now they have monitors. You can watch them all the time. But you want to keep an eye on them. You want to make sure they're safe, make sure they're doing well. Paul is saying, you need to be watched, and there is someone that is watching. You need to be cared for, and there is someone that is caring for you. But you have lost sight of that. And so the fact is that when one of you loses sight of that, the whole body suffers. And so the whole body is called to serve each other, to care for each other, to watch over each other. Leaders are servants. Paul and Apollos and Peter are simply servants, God's servants. And as servants, their job is to help build and care for the church. And so he goes on to this analogy of a garden where a seed is planted. Someone plants a seed. Someone else waters a seed. Someone cultivates and keeps the weeds out of the garden. But all of them are doing this for one purpose. The planter isn't any more important than the person that waters it. The person that waters it isn't any more important than the person that cultivates and keeps the weeds out. They are all very important. Without any of the three, the seed's not going to produce fruit. And the goal is, therefore, the same goal, so that the seed is able to germinate and grow, to develop and grow into a plant and produce seed for the harvest. Now, God has called us to be servants. And God uses human instruments. I think it was last week, we had graduation recognition and teacher recognition, and it was Mother's Day, and we had all the teachers and the people that helped with the educational program stand up, and we were somewhat amazed at how many people that involved. That's what happens in the church. Men and women are used by God as human instruments to help grow the church spiritually, to help encourage each other in their walk with God. Because we are servants not of the church. We are not servants of each other. We are servants of the Almighty God. And we act as co-workers, fellow workers. Paul's work wasn't any more important than Apollos' work. They were all part of God's plan. They were fellow workers doing the work of God. As you would probably consider and talk about your pastors. The pastors that you have had in the history of Stephenville Christian Reformed Church, each one of them has played a role in your development, in your journey, in your growth. Each one God has used to move you along in your journey. And often pastors will discover that God calls them to a church for a certain time, for a certain season. And when that season has come to an end, when that time has come to an end, God calls them and calls them to another place, another church, for another season, for another purpose. But each pastor moves people along in their journey of faith. And so Paul uses the field analogy. And he says, God uses servants, but God himself will build his church. Only God makes the church grow. We are simply servants serving a master. The second analogy he uses is a building analogy. And he says, I was the first contractor that came and I laid the foundation. The foundation was the gospel. The gospel that Jesus was crucified, that he died for our sins, that he was the Son of God, and that he rose again. And because of his resurrection, we have new life with Christ, and that allows us to be God's children. And because we are God's children, we are different people. We are a new people. That was the foundation. And he says, you can come along and build on that foundation any way you like. But remember the foundation. But also remember that when the day comes, the day of judgment, the final day, the day of fire, that depending on what you built your life on, depending on how you built your life on that foundation, if the fire consumes the things that you've built, that means that you weren't building with the right materials. You weren't following the code, right? The fire burnt it up. It's gone. It didn't matter. It wasn't the right stuff. But if you follow God's code and if you use the proper materials, the fire will not consume it. It'll be fireproof. But notice, the thing that caught my eye is that God is the builder, and so you use all these materials, but you ask God to use them to build. But God doesn't build with worldly things. He builds with spiritual things. And our life, our life is not conditional on what we have gained in our worldly life. Our life doesn't matter in the end on how much money we have, what the status of our name is, what we have accomplished, whether they build statues of us along the highway or in the city square, whether they have buildings named after us, that doesn't matter. What matters is that do you have the mind of God and the heart of Christ? As Paul says earlier in Corinthians, you have been richly blessed. You have received the heart of God, the mind of Christ. Now, what are you going to do with that? Are you going to argue and quarrel? Are you going to talk about the things that you've done are more important than the things that anybody else have done? Or are you going to work together and say, we're for our common cause, and God is going to use us because only God can grow His kingdom, His church, His people. And God works in our hearts. And God works in your heart. The church must be built with care. The third analogy he uses is the church is like God's temple. You'll remember in the Old Testament when they built the temple, there were specific things that they had to do, specific materials they had to use, and there were specific measurements that they had to go by. And all of these things were grand and fabulous because this was the place where God was going to dwell. After Christ's death and resurrection, God says, I'm going to dwell in your hearts. I'm going to dwell in each one of you. And your body is going to be my temple, the place where I dwell, my dwelling place. And so when we say that we come into God's presence in church, oh, God has a special place here, yes. I'm not sure if it's right here or if it's by the organ or the piano. I'd say organ, right? Organ's better than piano. Yeah. Maybe it's in the front bench. Maybe that's why nobody sits in the front bench. Or maybe he's back there by the coffee, drinking coffee, right? Listening. No, God is a special place, but remember that God is here in this place because God is here in each of our hearts. And we come here together as one body, as one people, because we are God's people. We come together to experience the fellowship with God's people, the fellowship with Christ. The church is God's dwelling place. And so, imagine. It was last week, I believe, when there was word about this Roe versus Wade, that there was going to be people marching in front of churches, and you saw in the news some churches were spray painted with terrible things, and so there was some concern that churches were going to be defaced. What a terrible thing to do. But wait a minute. Isn't that what we do? If we call ourselves the church, the body of Christ, and people see us and hear us doing things that deface who Jesus is, if they see and hear us doing things that dishonor and corrupt and pollute the temple, will not God deal so severely with those who corrupt His temple? His people? His church? Paul writes, "Now many of you are wise by human standards." And he says, if you live by these worldly standards, you are fooling yourselves. If any one of you thinks he is wise by the standards of this age, he should become a fool so that he would become wise. The foolish things of the world are the things that God uses. And so as God's temple, we recognize that God is the church, our life, our walk with Him is God's project, and He is going to complete that project. He's not going to stop. He's not going to give up. COVID isn't even going to stop it. He continues to do His work and complete His project. He never stops. As I look at my life, and I hope that the same is true in your life, as you look back in your life and you see all of the things that have happened and experienced in your life, I hope that you can see that God has been using and working in all of those experiences, in all those phases and seasons of your life, that He has been maturing you, that He has been growing you, that you are becoming not so much a better Christian, but more so have a better understanding of who God is, a better understanding of who you are before the face of God, and a better realization that you, that we are in desperate need of a Savior. And that we depend upon God for all things, that none of the things that we do matter unless God is involved, unless God is helping us. And God helps us. God is involved in our life for one purpose. That purpose is to honor Him. And so He is going to be working in our life, engaging in our life activities in order that we would acknowledge Him as how great is our God, worthy of all praise. Even when you're standing in the cow barn and that cow takes a you-know-what and it splatters all over you. It happens. How can I honor God doing that? Well, ask Him. He will use that to honor Himself. And the church not only is God's project, the church must be unified in Christ crucified, meaning that we all need Christ. None of us needs Him more or less. We all need Him the same. We all need Him ultimately, completely, fully. We share Him fully, His love fully. And so remember, the church is also the place where God's temple, where God dwells and does His work. It's his workshop. And so if we aren't about doing God's work, then why are we calling ourselves the church? Why are we part of the church if we aren't doing God's work? If we aren't part of God's workshop, if we aren't the busy servants doing God's work? We gather here to experience God's presence, to be a holy community, and to be open to seeing what God is doing, and to tell others, to share with others what God is doing in our life in our work, in our worship, not only on Sunday, but every day of the week. And so I'm going to ask you the question one more time. Are any of you wealthy enough to have servants in your house? Are any of you blessed with the richness and abundance of God's blessings to be able to call yourself a servant? Yes. God has loved us. God has called us, and He has sanctified us and set us apart, consecrated us, and we have become saints, not holy people. Remember, not holy people. Saints are people who are set apart for a purpose, and we are set apart to serve God, to serve each other. And to do it not for our own elevation, prominence, recognition, but for God's glory. Amen? Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you again for speaking to our hearts, for being patient with us, for acknowledging that we are slow learners. And even though we think that we are meat eaters, that we are spiritually mature, that in many ways we are still on the bottle, needing milk, very immature. We are infants in our faith at times. And so we ask, Lord, that we may recognize as we are being fed that you are the one who grows us, that you are the one who is doing the work, that it is not us, but that you are doing the work, and we are merely servants. And so help us, Lord, to be willing servants, instruments in your hand, remembering that we always serve you as the head, that we are always here to honor you as our master. Thank you, Father, for sending your Son and those who proclaim the message of salvation. Those who have told us the gospel message. And may that be the foundation of our life. And may you build upon that foundation in each of us with a servant heart. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.